Welcome back to our 12th and final installment or module of the Citizens Pension Academy. Our final topic is the art, literature, and music of pensions. Up in the Springfield headwaters of Oak Brook's Public Safety Pension Systems, if you listen very carefully, you can hear music. And if you follow the sound, they say that there are elves who gather in subterranean caverns under the Capitol Dome to sing songs, recite poems, and cast spells about the future. I don't know how much of that legend is really true, but in fact, there is a rich trove of art, music, and literature generated by pensions. Pension art is as real as the 1662 Rembrandt commissioned by the syndics of Amsterdam's Drapers Guild, dedicated to restricting entry to their business by imposing quality standards and mandatory certification, monopolizing supply, and dictating prices. Or perhaps this painting could depict earnest village trustees soberly reflecting on the mounting pension bills and mapping out a way to somehow pay for it. Or maybe this is a forerunner of a fire pension board meeting, deciding a claim for a line of duty disability without any objective medical evidence. It's open to interpretation. For over 100 years, this painting was hung in the Guildhall or Staalhof in Amsterdam. Today, this image is used to sell Dutch Masters cigars. Now, if a work of art can remind us of people in government, does it play the other way? Can people in government remind us of a work of art? Drawing on the academic discipline of critical pension theory, or CPT, let's see what power relationships we can identify in a drama and use these insights to deconstruct prevailing narratives constructed by those who dominate us for their benefit. Here are the three top Illinois government rulers, our governor, our Senate president, and our Speaker of the House, here shown at a maskless climate meeting held in November 2021 at Strathclyde University, offering a toast to the power of government to control the weather. This in turn reminds us of three figures from a Shakespeare play who are able to control the thunder and the rain to disturb the natural order of things. It's these three old hag witches whom Shakespeare used to deliver his prologue to Macbeth, to tell the future of who gets to the top of the Kingdom of Scotland, to control those lifetime hereditary government benefits. But must the witches always be as ugly and off-putting as this? How old do you think these witches are? What life expectancy table applies to witches who can shift their shapes from old hags to seductive young temptresses? Are they white collar or blue collar? Big problem for some actuary to resolve. As we saw in Module 4, Edmund Halley invented life expectancy prediction in about 1678, about 50 years after Shakespeare wrote these three witches into the prologue of Macbeth. Okay, now let's take a page from someplace like the Gender Studies Department of, say, Oberlin College, and put a pensioned reading into this old play. Let's say an Oak Brook firefighter finds himself married to one of the old witches in the prior slide, and then changes or shifts her out for a newer one from this slide. The same Illinois pension code that requires Oak Brook to guarantee a full 100% spousal rollover of the full value of the firefighter's pension to the old wife now will also require Oak Brook to guarantee that pension to the new younger wife. And the attorneys for the wives will work with the judge to allocate that future spousal rollover to both the ex-wife and the new wife. Since part of the charm of the new wife is her relative youth, that pension obligation Oak Brook must pay will be increased by the firefighter pension fund's actuary firm, and Oak Brook's actuary will double-check the math, which we trustees will vote to approve. The new allocated increment to the new wife, whose life expectancy table shoots higher than the old wife, will in effect increase the cost of the pension to Oak Brook, because the benefit increase to the new wife profile has a cost we must recognize. Anyway, back to the strict text of Macbeth without all the modern pension codes, semiotics, deconstruction, and outing of gendered power plays. In the story itself, witches can tell the future. So how is that inspiration for J.B. Pritzker, Dan Harmon, and Chris Welch to fly over to London on a carbon-spewing private jet to address climate change? That's where this literary example started. The answer must be that after these Illinois legislators discovered their power to make the Illinois pension river rise year after year, they now offer their services to the whole rest of the world to make the oceans rise higher. In the aftermath of these Shakespearean speculations about government power corrupting nature, we now resort to the calmer consolations of the Romance period of pension literature, where we find this elegiac poem by John Keats, Ode to Pension Debt, presented as a dramatic reading performed by three homeschool kingdom students.
Ode to Pension Debt by John Keats. O pension debt, if I must with thee dwell, let it not be among the jumbled heap of union contracts, disability claims, or 100% lifetime spousal benefits, all compounding 3% each year.
No, climb with me the calendar, see the long-term view. Once the budget, its flowery slopes, its coming swell, may seem a span, and let me there thy vigils keep, amongst boughs pavilioned, where actuaries are seen to leap, startling our officials, who must pay the growing bill.
But though I'll gladly trace these scenes with thee, yet the sweet converse of a trustee's mind, whose words are images of thoughts refined, is my soul's pleasure, and it sure must be almost the highest bliss of humankind. When with your vote to bear your hope, I'll work to set us free.
And for a novel presentation of pensions, Oak Park's very own Ernest Hemingway is shown here at his place in Cuba that he bought from a Frenchman with the proceeds of the sale of the film rights to A Farewell to Arms, written in 1929. His big game trophies adorn the walls. Imagine the muscular quality of the conversations coursing through the air at this table. In fact, his table is still there today, in one of the few buildings maintained to a high standard by the financially strained Communist Party of Cuba, along with the exact room with those same trophies, which I was able to admire during my visit to Cuba in 2012. The government at that time was trying to raise funds internationally to restore Hemingway's old Cadillac convertible still parked out in the adjacent garage. He used to drive that convertible into Havana to a certain bar off of Havana Harbor to drink his signature daiquiris and smash a lot of furniture to work out the stress of being such a great writer. This gave him clarity to write those famous short declarative sentences to make his points. On page 136 of his 1926 book titled The Sun Also Rises, Hemingway wrote this famous dialogue about how pensions end up becoming unpayable. How did you go bankrupt? Bill asked. Two ways, Mike said. Gradually, and then suddenly. Closer to home, here in Oak Brook, we host one of the greatest concentrations of nephrologists in the United States, and in fact the entire world. Oak Brook is at the leading edge of nephrology. How nephrology developed and what it can teach us about caring for pensions is the theme of this student drama. This is Oak Brook. You can handle some complex dialogic parallelism.
Nephrology is a new branch of medicine including treatment of
end-stage renal disease. ESRD.
Once 100% fatal and untreated, before dialysis and transplants. Now it's 10% of Medicare spending and 80%
began in 1969 in Church Basement, Forest Park, St. Peter's Evangelical Lutheran Church. Now, kidney transplants are routine, and the boundaries as well, including well-respected and crucial medical specialties. Yet, kidney disease is growing very fast through the American diet and lifestyle. We are inspired by nephrology and nephrologists, as we face similar problems in the infancy of diagnosis and treatment. American Municipal Finance and Pension Liability, in particular, as an NDD or
NDD,
which
some say is untreatable.
And now for some music. The Eagles started as a backup studio band to Linda Ronstadt, but soon emerged into their own, a few years after the Illinois Constitution of 1970 was ratified. Later, they teamed up with Joe Walsh, and are still out there playing a diminishing series of farewell tours. As they get closer to retirement, they've started to sing about pensions. This one is called Pension Blues, performed by James Albritton out of Florida with his acoustic adaptation, a third-person narrative perspective on our pension system.
There's trouble in the budget, I can feel it in my bones. Had a premonition that we're not in this alone. Knew the law was loaded, but I didn't think it killed. The numbers all exploded and the ink began to spill. The baby is your ticket, put the suitcase in your hand. There's little money now, do it just the way we planned. You'll be cool for 30 years to come, it's the laws of Lincoln's land. So it went down like this and someone had to lose. It's the nature of the business, it's the pension blues. Tenants in the law, pimps in the spousals and the things nobody saw. No matter if it's sweeteners, compound rates or cash, you've got to pay the difference cause investment incomes crash. Lots of shady characters, lots of dirty deals. Every Springfield boss is working union-driven bills. Lure busy money has got a very strong appeal. Perhaps you understand it better, standing in my shoes. The ultimate enticement is the pension blues. Yeah. You see it in the headlines, you hear it every day. They say they're gonna stop it, but it doesn't go away. They move it through committees, sell it early in the day. They hide it in life expectancies, I mean it's here to stay. It's dragging down the governments from Oak Brook to the Loop. You ask any actuary, they say there's nothing we can do. The office of the governor right down to me and you, me and you. It's a loser problem. proposition, but one you can't refuse. Politics of pensions, the pension blues, yeah.
Another song modifies the perspective of the singer through a song originally by a band called Social Distortion. The lyrics impose a kind of first-person anthropomorphism onto a pension fund, and the pension fund proceeds to sing about itself. The complexity of the guitar work reflects the dynamic, runaway character of the costs flowing from the pension clause of the Illinois Constitution.
For them yours always increases, paychecks, perks galore. All you taxpayers, women and kids, best get out of the way. I just nailed your town, took all your loot, fought with big donations to the Springfield suits, hopped up union lobbyists wearing two-toed shoes. And I'm already gone. I left the pool of dead in sorrows. It's the pension rules, pension rules. I'll be out of here for the break of dawn. Hit the highway, smoke a big cigar. Gotta stop, bury your cash, get some more. There's only one thing on my mind. So making it across that old state line without a hail of legislation trying to fix me. And I'm already gone. I've left the path to destruction, which the judges say is cool. And I'm already gone. Your life will soon be through, but your brand new young spouses are signed up for me too. I'm public enemy number one. Sorry for the things that I've done. The DVD do cross paths, it's nothing personal. And you got the bill to prove it, and I'm already gone. The time will soon be through, thanks to me, the Illinois Constitution and JB2.
Art and literature of pensions can cross generations, unite people from everywhere. Down in Springfield, the public safety union activists know this as they regularly gather inside the Capitol building under the dome at the very headwaters of the Illinois Pension River to rhythmically shout out their demands over and over for hours in a sort of secular Gregorian chant of the daily office, invoking the earthly blessings of eternally increasing government benefits. Each time I visit Springfield with the DuPage mayors and managers to talk to our legislators, we can barely hear ourselves over the incessant din raised by these syncopated chants echoing up from the first floor of the rotunda and bouncing their acoustics off the walls, amplifying all the way up to the brightly painted ceiling of the dome. It's the power of music, or maybe the music of power. Well, we've now enjoyed this excursion into more dimensions of these liberal arts to embrace and extend a variation on the theme set by the Interlochen Academy for the Arts, which says, dedicated to the promotion of pension understanding through the universal language of the arts. Well, a special thank you to the artists who have contributed their critical insights, freedom of expression, and talent to this final episode or module of the Oak Brook Citizens Pension Academy. Your work reminds us that no matter where we find ourselves, we have the power of creative agency to summon first the hope and then the change to make something new. A reason to say, yes, we can. That's it. You've done it. You've now completed the Oak Brook Citizens Pension Academy, an inside look at what it's like to be a village trustee dealing with our fire and police pensions. We've looked into the elements, framework, key characters, trends, values, and future of these pensions, and the claims they impose on our budget. If knowledge is power, you now have more of it. If you've completed all 12 modules, let me know, and I'll send you your own personalized certificate of completion, which you can request by sending me an email to ed@teasinga.com. Thank you for attending and for the opportunity to serve you as an Oak Brook Village trustee and from that standpoint to fellowship together with you in our community. We share some important work. This pension thing permeates all of it.